Welcome back. We had just a great day. Wasn't it a good day yesterday? I mean, technology, applications, it was really a great warm-up for today. Today we're very privileged actually to have a keynote speaker, actually a duo from the Audubon Society who are bringing the science of where to life. They'll speak to you. They'll speak to your heart. They'll speak to your mind. They'll show you an amazing system that they built for the entire country to support NGOs. So before I introduce the actual speakers, I want to show a short video to give you a quick glance at what they do.
Before the ArcGIS platform, our state conservation and bird experts, along with our national science experts, were all working off of disconnected databases. Being able to share data lets them collaborate and lets them come up with much more robust, larger conservation visions. It's completely transformed how we think about conservation and where we target our work.
We have volunteers collaborating with staff in a new way, collaborating with partners in a new way, using our GIS as a big spatial platform for collaboration.
The Sagebrush Songbird Survey is a partnership between Audubon Washington and the Department of Fish and Wildlife, in which we use the ArcGIS platform to engage 7 Eastern Washington chapters to gather data on shrub steppe songbird species in such a rigorous manner that citizen science data is actually used by agencies.
Audubon showed up supporting this GIS platform. We all of a sudden were using the tools to actually figure out the sites and navigate to them ourselves. The scale of collaboration is just way beyond anything I had imagined.
Citizen science, I'm convinced, is going to play a bigger part in how we manage our resources and collect information for managing resources in the future. One of the great things about this project with Audubon is that they are taking on the role of monitoring their citizen scientists. And this project that we've developed really allows the Department of Fish and Wildlife to provide guidance to the state organization and the state organization to provide guidance to the chapters.
A group of us actually got together at our house. We got several laptops on the dining room table, and we had a representative from Esri come and coach us about how to navigate through ArcGIS online. Then we went out in the field and began to survey all of the dozen sites that are scattered around our county here.
This ArcGIS platform has really enabled a grassroots effort to connect with state and national offices in a way that this work that has such meaning to all of us has been able to grow organically into something that has become really powerful and regional and meaningful to all of us.
I'm really excited about what we've done as an organization, what GIS is doing for the conservation community, but also for the nonprofit community. The technology is so accessible, everyone accepts and is excited that GIS is in their toolbox.
Having the ArcGIS platform be part of Audubon's DNA has helped us produce better science. It's helped us produce better plans. That in turn has helped us do more effective fundraising. It has increased our credibility with our partners. And most of all, it fulfills Audubon's core mission. It lets our local chapters be authentic, credible voices in their communities for birds and for people.
Cool, huh? So, I have the distinct honor, and I really mean that, of introducing you to David Yarnold. He's both my personal friend and a mentor in conservation. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming David Yarnold. Thanks, David.
Thanks so much. Hi, good morning. It's a treat to be here with you, and it's always great to be with Jack and the Esri team. So I want to tell you today about the reinvention of a 112-year-old legacy conservation organization that put GIS at the heart of its makeover. I've been at Audubon for 6.5 years. 2 years into that tenure, my board chair said to me, you know, the thing I didn't want to tell you was that Audubon was actually a testament to how hard it is to kill a great brand. I said, I'm kind of glad you didn't tell me that before I took the job. When I took the job, there were 23 state offices, 463 chapters, 41 nature centers, and no shared vision. No shared vision. An organization that had veered off course, that had done fabulous work in certain geographies like Alaska, where we helped draw the maps for the Bureau of Land Management around the National Petroleum Reserve, in Wyoming, around sage-grouse habitat, in Florida, around the Everglades. But the staff told me when I joined Audubon that we are the sum of our parts. And I told them after, after being out in Audubon world for a month, on a first staff call, the first all-staff call I was on, I said, actually, you are parts. So I came to Audubon with a journalism background. I'm a recovering journalist. I ran the San Jose Mercury News. Shout out for San Jose, that's great. I fell up the ladder at the Mercury News until I ended up running the whole thing. I started as the paper's first picture editor and a designer. And for me, visual communication, the ability to share ideas visually, is fundamental. How many times have you told yourself, usually after some bad experience, show, don't tell, right? That became a mantra for me in journalism, and the Mercury News became known for its visual journalism as well as all of its journalism, and the International Society of News Design said that we were one of the 5 best designed papers in the world, and this is what they said. So to date myself, I was a part of this wave of visual journalism when USA Today started, and color and format, and New York Times started doing graphics. And the Mercury News, which was the first newspaper online in 1994, 28K dial-up newspapers, it wasn't news by the time it loaded. I was really excited when, for the very first time, a graphic led the front page. This was our lead graphic. This was, like, not a photograph, this was the top half of the front page. There was an oil spill in San Francisco Bay. And to this day, I keep this map on my desk to keep me humble. So you can see the part where it says, oil spill. You can probably also see the dam that runs from San Francisco to Oakland. You can see the freshwater ship channel that cuts through the heart of Berkeley. You can see how the ports of Tiburon and Belvedere and Berkeley have been filled in. And the problem is, it's all wrong. And we ran it on the front page. What happened, okay, so this is actually pre-computer graphics. The artist went into the library and pulled out a base map of the San Francisco Bay, and he added oil spill. The map was a futurist projection of what the bay could look like in 2020. It was total fiction, but it was our first lead graphic. So the idea of the science of where resonates with Audubon, it resonates with me as a leader, because I have been able to lead organizations ranging from the Mercury News to Environmental Defense Fund to helping to drive the reinvention of Audubon with visual communication at the center of what we do. And I hope today I give you some ideas that you can take back to your agencies, your firms, and your work. So, birds, really? Birds can drive large-scale conservation work. This is what Dr. Thomas Lovejoy, one of the leading experts in biodiversity, said to me when he looked at our new strategic plan. Really? Is that true? If you follow the birds, can you really get to the big problems in the world? Well, yeah, if you follow the snail kite, you end up in the Everglades, one of America's gems and an ongoing restoration project. You end up in Alaska, where Audubon helped draw that map that helped preserve 11 million out of 23 million acres in the National Petroleum Reserve 4 years ago. We have a crackerjack mapping team in Alaska that works in close partnership with the Bureau of Land Management. You can follow birds to the Gulf Coast. When I flew over the Deepwater Horizon and felt the heat rising through the bottom of a seaplane and saw this vision from hell, this is what I was thinking about. This is what we have the opportunity to restore, and Audubon was one of the three nonprofits that was a major driver to help pass the legislation that will send BP and Halliburton's penalty monies to restore the Gulf Coast, and our goal is to help make sure that we build coastline and not parking lots. So this is how Audubon gets to it work. Its work. We follow the birds to our work. So there are four superhighways in the sky above North America. Some of you know this. Most of the people I show this to don't. The Atlantic, the Central, the Mississippi, and the Pacific. These are superhighways in the sky, and our goal is to protect the rest stops and the homes beneath them. Our job is to protect the tipping points. This map didn't exist before I got to Audubon. This was not how Audubon thought of itself. And for sure, this isn't how Audubon thought of itself. 463 chapters, 22 state offices in most of the truly important state capitals, 21 nature centers, 41 nature centers, and 25 sanctuaries. And when you slice these up by flyway, this is what Audubon's asset map looked like. So this is the map that didn't exist because Audubon didn't think of itself as flyways. Audubon thought of itself and had an incentive system and had a structure that was all about state offices. And it was all about individual centers. It wasn't even, for many of them, about birds. I visited a nature center in Phoenix. I walked through the nature center, and I got to the very last diorama, and I saw a bird on its side, on the bottom of the diorama. And the opportunity for Audubon to come to a shared vision around protecting birds throughout the flyways of the Americas was a powerful way to glue together an organization that was highly siloed. None of you know about siloed organizations, right? So this was my aha moment driven by GIS. I didn't actually see this coming. So the question we were trying to answer is if you wanted to build an air bridge from Maine to Chiloé Island in Chile, what would be the most important forest blocks to protect? And so when we would get our state directors together to answer a question like that, I remember this vividly, they'd all come in with PDFs, hard copies of maps that consultants helped them produce in Pennsylvania and New York and Florida and South Carolina. And guess what each map and each state director said? They said, my forest block is the most important to protect. That's what needs funding. But when Doreen Whitley entered the scene and we began to use authoritative shared data and generated the answers to those questions from that kind of collaborative process, the whole thing changed. The whole thing changed. And that's the story I first told Jack Dangermond. I said, Jack, we're using GIS to drive cultural change, organizational change. We're remaking a 112-year-old conservation organization using GIS and the science of where at the heart of what we do. And so this map came about in the way that everything comes about when I sit down and talk to our Geospatial Information Officer Doreen Whitley. She talks to me for about a half an hour, and I find it endlessly fascinating because I was raised in Silicon Valley, and I listen to all of it, and then I recite back like three paragraphs condensing what she said. And I ask, is that about right? And that's how we work, and that's how that story came to light. So let me tell you what our second generation strategic plan looks like. This plan answers two questions. First, what if Audubon thought about itself as the most effective network for conservation in America? I'm going to show you why there's no other network that looks like Audubon. And two, if Audubon, for the first time in its history, maybe since its founding, when we stopped the slaughter of birds for feathers for hats, maybe for the first time in more than 100 years, if Audubon tried to answer the question, how much good could we do if we really lived up to our potential? That's what this plan is about. Okay, it's a lot of words. I'm sorry, there won't be any more slides that have this many words. These are the five priorities that we have: climate, coastal resilience, water, working lands, and bird-friendly communities. Bird-friendly communities is a sensational initiative around making sure that there's food, water, and safe passage for birds in the places where people live. Birds are a fabulous window onto conservation, as Tom Lovejoy said. 47 million people tell the Fish and Wildlife Service that they love birds, second only to gardening as an activity. 47 million. That's a massive audience. Audubon has 1 million members, and we reach 5 million. There are tens of millions more who care about birds and are increasingly paying attention to Audubon's social media, to our conservation strategies, and to a really, really important fact in a new political climate, and I'm going to share that with you in a minute. So we don't think, conservation organizations are challenged at this moment, but we don't think that the fetal position is a fighting position. We actually believe that we're going to be able to make a lot of progress over the next 4 years by working in states primarily on our conservation priorities, and I'm happy to talk with you about this after, and all of this is available at audubon.org. So these are the four things that I'd like you to remember about Audubon. The fact is, we scale. So our work, whether it's in Arizona or in Washington, wherever we are, it all scales up to state capitals, and it builds up to Washington, D.C., where there are legislators who we believe will be champions for conservation. We're local everywhere. I'm a veteran of the 2008-2009 climate initiative that we worked on when I was at Environmental Defense Fund. And the thing that was missing, so we got passage in the House and it never got taken up in the Senate, and there was only one thing missing from that initiative around climate legislation. Just one thing. 10 million beating hearts. The legislators would go home and there were nobody in the seat. Nobody was in the seats. There was nobody demanding change from the grassroots. There was no grassroots component. Being local everywhere says that in Arizona, we're going to have constituents who want to talk about yellow-billed cuckoos. In New Orleans, they're going to want to talk about brown pelicans. In the Northeast, they're going to want to talk about painted buntings. In Minnesota, they're going to want to talk about loons. And we're on the leading edge of technology and communications, or at least we're somewhere in view of the leading edge, which is not something the conservation organizations usually try to do. And this is that thing that I wanted to share with you. We create common ground. At a time when America needs it most, Audubon's membership is 52% progressive, 48% moderate and conservative. Tell me another organization you know that looks like that. And birds are common ground. It's really a fabulous thing. When I'm at a chapter meeting in Lincoln, Nebraska, and I'm looking out over a crowd, I can't tell a Democrat from a Republican. Imagine that. What I see are people who think that conservation is a bird issue. And because we follow birds to our work, we do partnerships. Birds lead us to partnerships. This is just one example of what a Western sandpiper does for Audubon. And of course, this is true along all of America's coastlines. One of the things that matters most to me about Audubon is that we can answer the question that people have around environmental and conservation issues. What can I do? What can I do? Climate change, habitat fracturing, coastal erosion, it all just seems so overwhelming. But being able to tell people, you can plant native plants on your patio or in your backyard. You can patrol beaches on every coast in America like 10,000 volunteers do. You can go onto our website and tell and look at the birds that you love and that mean something to you and your life and your family, and tell them about the birds you love and the threats they face. You can do something. So I'd like to bring out Doreen Whitley, our geospatial information officer, who will tell you about the really exciting back-end part of this, the true heart of what we do, the GIS work. Doreen.
Thank you, David, and thank you for putting up with my geospeak all these years. As I look at this timeline and I look out at this audience, I have to recognize that many of you are part of this story through your mentorship and advice and technical sessions in the hallways and through endless emails, so I want to thank you. And I know that if you have ideas or feedback on what I say today, I will hear from you. So in 2011, as Audubon embarked upon its transformation from an organization operating in silos to a one Audubon model, as David mentioned, it wasn't hard to figure out the technology. The issues were cultural, mainly because staff centered and connected around their expertise and their activities. So there were little unified efforts. So of course, our GIS mimicked this stovepipe structure. When I started talking to my colleagues about doing an enterprise GIS, they would say, oh great, I'll email you my GIS. I was like, okay, you're gonna send me a shapefile or something? And I would get folders zipped with PDFs and JPEGs that consultants had made. So the little GIS we had was in pockets. Data was stored locally. There were no standards. There was no maintenance on it. And we had a small group of fabulous desktop analysts, about 20, but they were disconnected. So in 2012, we encouraged and opened up an enterprise GIS, which brought not only over 1,000 new users to working with and making maps, but more importantly, it created this new space for collaboration and a single frame of reference for our work. This was integral to moving to this flyway structure and beginning to build strong regional projects. This is where you guys come in, because this is what I've talked about with you over the years at this meeting and Esri you see and on listservs and blogs. We needed to ensure that our GIS not only continued to evolve, but it needed to function as a lever that we pull on to move our organization's goals. It needed to be iterative and flexible. In order to manage that, we created the first enterprise staff for Audubon. Finally, dedicated staff responsible for centralizing and distributing spatial data, introducing emerging technologies. So we had to recruit new talent. We were fortunate to bring on board a formerly trained software engineer that had done similar projects for some agencies you might know, like NASA and DOD. So now this flexible framework supports an organization initiatives versus these local activities that Audubon was spending a lot of resources to do. So now we're refining our spatial data model to reflect the current needs of working together on conservation initiatives and less about our local geographies. So this allows us to not only build regional projects across flyways, but to also integrate them. So our model is driven by two things: authoritative data, but more importantly for a nonprofit, and I'm sure you're feeling this now in your agencies, resource optimization. With this structure, our analysts can focus on quantitative projects. We're contributing to federal clearinghouses like Science Base. And now that GIS is integrated through our network, we can use more web-based products to grow our footprint by actively engaging citizens. So while there will always be a spectrum of skills across our user base, staff and volunteers are actively using GIS in their day-to-day work. It's like opening Word or Excel or Outlook on your desktop. You don't need to call the map guy anymore, or girl. So GIS has truly become this connective tissue of this widely decentralized organization. I'm excited because moving forward, Audubon has learned from this enterprise model, and as we adapt more enterprise applications, we're working to integrate versus duplicate functionality. And we have a new view to our IT. We look at it as a system of smaller systems that includes GIS. Our goal is that no application, data set, or device is an island. And this is critical to our work at both local and national scales. And I'll let David share some examples of this. Thank you.
Thanks, Doreen. So now we're going to talk about the things that really help turbocharge Audubon's reinvention. But I want to take a step back and make sure you understand, help you understand what Audubon looked like in 2010. A budget of $73 million that had been in deficit for a dozen years. A board that had to bail the staff out by hitting reserves for a dozen years. A board that gave less than the staff. A senior management team that had become accustomed to having no mission, no glue, no focus, and came to work every day to do that because they cared about Audubon and they cared about their piece, but they knew that it didn't scale. Today, $102 million budget with a goal of $150 million by 2020 per year. Completely new management team, all of the business side people hired from the for-profit world. GIS at the heart of what we do, an 11-person science team based here in Washington who are all spatial data analysts or experts who are doing cutting-edge accountability work that I'll share with you in a minute. And a total failure of imagination. A view that Audubon's chapters were unmanageable and a pain to deal with. Those of you who know Audubon, and I'm sure there are many of you out here who do, know that the National Audubon Society had basically dissed its chapters for two decades. The first thing I do is I sent out a note with the announcement about the selection committee's poor judgment to select me. I sent out a note that said, let me tell you about this great birding trip I went on to Iceland. And I told them about the dozen species of loons that we saw and a gear falcon. And I said, and that's all I got. That's all I got. Not a birder. Will you help me learn? And when I did that, the chapter said, sure. And so, what our local work looks like now is very often driven by our chapters. Instead of being a pain to communicate with and a burden to try to steer, our chapters are a distributed network. I looked at the chapters and said, holy cow, if I went to one of my Silicon Valley friends and said, hey, I've got this idea for a startup, 463 chapters, 22 state offices, a million members, would you fund that? They'd say, oh, hell no. And I said, oh, actually, I don't need it. That's my installed base. And so what we said to the chapters was, we'd like to help you learn GIS. And if you know GIS, we'd like to help you populate, we'd like to help you propagate those skills across our network. And so there was that spike that you saw in the line about the number of GIS users. We got $1 million investment from a technology hedge fund leader in Silicon Valley who helped us field a team of trainers that helped us triple the number of qualified GIS users. And so what happened? What happened is in states all over America, chapters took the initiative to make significant conservation gains in places from Oregon to Pennsylvania. In Idaho, the Golden Eagle Audubon Society worked with the Bureau of Land Management to help move 150 miles of high-powered transmission lines that were in prime migration corridors using GIS maps as their shared vision of what a future might look like for birds in that region. And that's the thing I love about GIS, is that it takes ideas out of your head and it puts them on the table. I don't know how many of you have had the experience, but I sure have as a designer and somebody who thinks about graphics, where I'll describe something to somebody, you know, a map or a graphic, or, and then I'll find out that it actually had no relationship to what they heard, right? But the thing about GIS is you can iterate shared visions of the future. That's why the science of where matters so much. So our chapters are doing powerful work globally. Using Collector, we were able in the Bahamas to protect 140,000 acres of wintering habitat for piping plovers, the cutest little bird you could possibly imagine. Many of you know it. We discovered, along with scientists from the University of Maryland, that there were these small islands, K's, in the Bahamas, where 30 or 40% of the wintering population of piping plovers went. And so we went from discovering them to having a 140,000-acre national park in 3 years. That's the kind of impact a distributed network can have using tools like Collector and others. We were one of the first users working with GIS and Alan and his terrific team to do a map story. And so this map story was about finding the piping plovers. And we coordinated our magazine with it. We coordinated our social media. Our social media, by the way, 5 years ago, we had 35,000 people on our Facebook page. We clicked 1 million in November. That's the kind of focused, targeted growth that we've seen. And this was a great map story. You could follow that heroic little bird all the way down to the Bahamas, and the idea of doing a year in the life of a piping plover, this illustrated for our whole network, for our state offices, for us, and for Esri, what a partnership would look like and how much attention you could get by using visual communication. So Audubon reinvented its website a year ago. If you haven't seen audubon.org, I would urge that you do that. After we reinvented our website, we got calls from Stanford University and Harvard, and they both said to me, I knew the person at Stanford used to be a reporter for me, and she was top of their communications team, and they said, we know who your consultant was in San Francisco when you reinvented the website. How much of that was them? How much of that was you? Because we want our website to look like that. And after I got done laughing, I said, your website will never look like that because ours is visually driven. I said, yours will never do that because you're academics and you will put all the words on the page. So that map story helped turn into actual policy and strategy. And of course, at some point, you have to not look at maps. And of course, the question that we're trying to answer here is, in the face of sea level rise, for whatever's causing that, in the face of sea level rise, what are we going to do? Are we going to build a wall all along the Atlantic coast and the Gulf coast and the Pacific coast? Or are we going to build resilient natural wetlands so that we can create the kinds of buffers that New Orleans didn't have when Katrina came slamming through? In addition to that, we're now using a next stage of mapping to find what we're calling strongholds, the places that will are likely to persist and be resilient places for birds, regardless of what happens with climate. And in North Carolina, we had a program last year where we enlisted 100 new ambassadors for climate. We focused on the key geographies, and only half of these people were Audubon members, because we know that the greatest growth in the Audubon movement is going to come outside of our chapters. It's going to come online, and it's going to come through people who want to answer that question, what can I do? And this, many of you will love this. It is not the most exciting slide in this deck, but it is the most exciting idea in conservation right now. Our commitment to create greater accountability focused on actual outcomes for birds, not surrogate habitat, not process, not number of meetings attended, not number of staff hired, but actual outcomes for birds. Those are the kinds of things, those are the kinds of hard outcomes and the kind of accountability that we're going to need in order to enlist a new generation of conservation practitioners and investors. And we're just beginning to pilot this. This is a beta version of what these pages will look like. And we're really excited about this, and we're deeply committed to changing how Audubon accounts for its conservation, and we hope others will join us. So we went from that place in 2010 that I described to you to 2014, where as a result of a 7-year investigation, our chief scientist published the results of that study that looked at the underlying elements of climate, everything from humidity to temperature to aridity, and looked at the UN's models around climate change, and ended up with the conclusion that nearly half of America's species are at risk of losing more than 50% of their habitat by 2080. If you go back and you look at this online, the entries will start with the National Audubon Society said today that nearly half of America's species are at risk. This was a watershed moment for Audubon because we said this is the greatest threat to birds and to people. And as I said to you before, we've tested, we know what happens when we talk to bird lovers about this issue. Whether it's testing our conservative members in North Carolina and Ohio, or just sitting down with Audubon members across the country, I know that for them, this is a bird issue. They don't want, we don't get hung up on the politics of it. We actually find that thing that is truly precious in America today, and that's common ground. And so when you go to our website, and you see Baird Sparrow, which unfortunately does not have a bright future, you can dive into this, and you can find, if you're in the Mississippi Flyway, you can find the brown pelican. And then you'll find this GIF, you'll find this map. There are 314 of these GIFs on our website. And what you'll see is that in terms of wintering range, there will still be habitat for brown pelicans even in 2080. The problem is it's 60 miles inland. Not a lot of fish there. And so what we said to our members when we launched the climate initiative is we would like you to do two things because we know that you love birds. We want you to take care of the places the birds are going to need now and are going to need in the future, regardless of what happens with the climate. And two, we want you to commit to working with us to address the underlying causes of climate change. And so Audubon is both in the adaptation and the mitigation space. It's not something a lot of conservation organizations do or say, but because we're a conservation organization, the adaptation part is a part of what we've done throughout our history. Our members understand that. And they're mobilizing on the mitigation part. They're mobilizing around climate action in states and when the opportunity arises at the federal level. So when we did the launch, here's something I want to share with you, and you know this. News outlets now love map data. They love the ability to make graphics. In fact, a major news organization decided that it wasn't going to cover the launch of our climate initiative, and I went to hit that person's top editor because I worked with her at the Mercury News, and I said, you know, there are great graphics to be done with this story. And then by the time I got into the office, he had called my PR person and called me a lot of unspeakable names and said, okay, we'll do the story. New York Times, AP, Washington Post, National Geographic all worked with us. They embargoed the news around our climate launch and agreed to do it in large part because they were able to create graphics on their own. So my advice to you, and I may be preaching to the converted here, my advice to you and to your teams and your supervisors is to recognize that as you pitch media to cover your work, data is really valuable. GIS is a great part of a pitch. It's not how most media people and PR people think about pitching stories, but you've got something absolutely golden, and we saw that at work with our climate initiative. So to answer that question about what you can do, we recognize that native plants were a great apolitical way to bring people to action. There was just one problem. If you wanted to enter your zip code and find out what native plants to put in your yard in Loudoun or Bethesda or here in DC, you couldn't. That database didn't exist. We knew that native plants mattered. An oak tree has 500 plus species of insects. A non-native ginkgo, 5. It's obvious that native plants are better for birds, insects, and people. But that database had to be built. So we built that database. We worked with our chapters. We worked with our state offices. Doreen's team drove this. We were committed to doing a zip code-based search that returns something like this. So this is a New York-based zip code. It'll tell you what plants. It'll show you what birds. If you have a particular affinity for nuthatches and you just want to search by nuthatches, you can do that. If you have a particular affinity for dogwoods, you can do that. And then you can go to the page that says local resources, and it directs you to local nurseries and online nurseries where you can make the yard of your dreams come true. It wasn't as easy as we thought it would be. Like, as soon as I said database, you knew that that was true, that it wasn't going to be as easy as we thought it was going to be. And the reason is because big counties like San Bernardino County, oh gosh, it's San Bernardino where Redlands is. San Bernardino County has so many hardiness zones that we actually had to go in to more than 500 counties using GIS and overlay hardiness zones county by county so that when you entered a zip code, because there are multiple zip codes within San Bernardino, you actually got plants that accounted for, you got returns that accounted for elevation change, for type of soil, I mean, all sorts of things. And Doreen's team drove that. And so here, stone's throw from here, in Baltimore, Maryland, this is a backyard with 50% of native plants. Teresa's been an urban conservationist since 2013. Our goal is to have 1 million native plants planted by March. We'll exceed that goal. The website, when it went live, it just crushed all of its numbers. 200,000 independent 200,000 separate users within like 2 months. It also generated 15,000 new email addresses for Audubon, and all of them will be solicited to take climate action. Okay, so here's my view of how an organization ought to work. And that is the short version of my message is, you all ought to be in the room when the programs are being conceived, not after they're conceived. That your work will be better, your agencies will get more value out of what you know, if you're in the room when the work, the programs, the initiatives, the targets, the audiences, the geographies are being discussed early on and in early stages. Because I know that what happens is that very often that planning gets way down the road and they say, shouldn't we bring in the map people? And that's not what the organization of the future is going to look like. The organization of the future is not going to be hierarchical and think about visual communication last. It's going to understand that the science of where and the opportunity for citizen science engagement, for public engagement, rests in no small part on what you bring to the table. So that would be my other message for your teams, your bosses, your firms, your agencies, and that is that in a data-driven world, you need to be at the table early on and throughout the process. That's what we strive for at Audubon. We're not perfect. We don't do it all the time. We make the same mistakes that, you know, we've made for years, but we're a lot better at it than we used to be. And the future for Audubon is bright. I know the stereotype that many of you have about what an Audubon member looks like. We love her. She donates a lot of money. She's a great birder. I love that floppy hat she wears. I like to go out with her. But actually, this is what Audubon looks like. If you give a kid a decent pair of binoculars and you ask them, why do you think their bill is shaped that way? Why do you think that their legs are that long? What they'll discover is that every bird is a gateway to an ecosystem. These are Audubon members. No, I'm not doing that. And these are Audubon members. So, I'd leave you with this thought. That as you look at the conservation challenges of 2017 going forward, being able to find a bird that is local, that is a part of your family's life, it may be a part of your daily walk, it may be a bird that you know meant a lot to your parents, it speaks to a geography that you care about. If you go on our website, you'll find those birds in all those geographies. That if you go back to Tom Lovejoy's quote about how if you follow the birds, you'll get to the big problems in the world, my last thought for you would be this. Now, right now, more than ever, you're what hope looks like to a bird and to our kids. Thanks for your time and attention. I'll be around to talk with you later.
This is great.
That was fun.
You are great.
Thanks. That was fun.
Should we have some conversation?
Sure.
We have 3 minutes.
Great. Let's do it.
You guys have any questions of David? Yes.
Yeah,
so repeat the question, David.
So how does our work, say our climate work, How does that ladder up with other organizations? So we share that data with anybody that wants it. We have worked with local conservation trusts. Lots of them have come to us for that data. And I've got a really important announcement that I just can't make today about a big, broad initiative. And just not there yet. But yes, we want to share that data.
Well, I think my interpretation of your question is how can federal agencies and state and local agencies and other vendors of data share information in such a way that it provides a platform for direct use of that data by Audubon? And I think that's one of the transformational things that we're going to see in the next couple of years. I mean, the world is full of individual players and stovepipes. I think you sort of made that clear. We all see the world because of our mission, because of our charter, because of our activities. We work this way. I mean, we're divided into ologies, you know, geology, climatology. All the sciences are divided that way. Our agencies, DHS, Census, EPA, we're all mission-focused. We're organized that way. Yet, the information that we create is geographic. And so the big transformation that we are going to, all of us are going to witness, is the idea that we can share that information in a kind of fabric of geography, so that the digital twin of geography, our world, comes alive, you know, as a platform.
Yeah.
And that means public, private, industry sharing of information, and being able to replicate holistic thinking in the digital space like we do in our mind. We walk out there, we see all the relationships, so how do we bring that back together? So that's my thought on it. I suppose we don't have mics or anything like that, but let me just say, David is one of my great heroes. Isn't he one of your heroes? I mean, unbelievable to me.
This is a mutual admiration society.
And his work is not just leading, but enabling digital realization of your mission. And I think he's a model for us. The Audubon is a model for us. I mean, the statistics, they did not share, neither him nor Doreen, very well. I mean, this is an organization that has horizontalized, integrated, is that the right word, and brought their organization to life using the science of wear. And so I'm committed to the Audubon Society. I'll do anything you want, David. <right? laughs> and I want you guys to be as well.
Now, this Thank is a great you. Partnership. Doreen and I will be at our booth to talk for a while, and please email us. And if you want to work for us, you can do that too.
Yeah, oh, I see there's a plug here. I knew it was coming, directly or indirectly.
Thanks,
Thank you,
Jack.
David. Okay. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank
We're
you.
Gonna go. Thanks.